For all of you joining us on Facebook Live, we welcome you this morning as well. This is the day that the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. Let us now begin our worship service by doing our call to worship that is found in your bulletin. I am the Alpha and the Omega, says the Lord God, who is and who was and who is to come, the Almighty. Worthy is Christ, who has ransomed us by his blood from every tribe and tongue and nation, and made his people a kingdom and our priests to God. Happy day indeed today. It is a happy day indeed. We want to thank Kim Conant and J.K. for lending their beautiful voices. Yes, J.K. was the one singing on that song. So we know she was gifted piano player, but we had no idea that she was gifted in singing. So thank you, J.K., for sharing that spiritual gift with us. Let us hear how happy of a day it is as we hear the words of Psalm 100. Make a joyful noise to the Lord, all the earth. Worship the Lord with gladness. Come into his presence with singing. Know that the Lord is God. It is He that made us, and we are His. We are His people and the sheep of His pasture. Enter His gates with thanksgiving and His courts with praise. Give thanks to Him. Bless His name. For the Lord is good. His steadfast love endures forever, and His faithfulness to all generations.
Good morning, everyone. Those of you on Facebook Live, make sure the children get up close. And really, this is for everybody this morning, not just the children of our congregation. So I'm going to reemphasize one of the verses that Joey just read, and that is verse 4 of Psalm 14 and Psalm 100. And you actually can see part of it back here on our beautiful Thanksgiving sign. Enter His gates with thanksgiving and His courts with praise. Give thanks to Him and bless His name. We know what Thursday is. And yes, we do have a lot to be thankful for. We are an incredibly grateful people. We are now able to join in person. Those of you on Facebook Live, we can't wait to see you again. There's so many things we can do other than just joining together in person to worship God. CAB is an incredible service that we provide our community. I encourage you, go to your pantry, go to the Food Lion, the IGA, the Kroger, the Publix, wherever you do your shopping, and get cans of food for those who really need it. Can you imagine, and I just pulled this out of the cupboard this morning, somebody might not have this on Thanksgiving. Can you imagine? Can you imagine not being able to reach into the cupboard and getting out a can to serve your family? This is where we come in. This is where we can help as a people of God. Enter in His courts with thanksgiving. Walk into the door of that Food Lion and buy some cans. We're very fortunate in that, one, we're having some service done on our gas logs tomorrow. And the company that is servicing them has said, we will take $20 off if you give us 10 cans of food. What a wonderful idea, and what a wonderful service that this company in Blythewood is providing to CAB. I encourage you all, give to those who are less fortunate, because we have a lot to give. Give it at Thanksgiving, give it after Thanksgiving. Also encourage you to go to Facebook, and if you can't find it, we'll have a way to get it out to you. There's an Advent calendar that's been posted for a couple of years that gives you something every day to put in a box to give to CAB starting December 1st. I think the first box is like a box of mashed potatoes or, you know, macaroni and cheese. I encourage you to do that because we have so much to be thankful for, and we need to share that with everyone. So if we could say a prayer of thanksgiving, please bow your head. Father God, we thank You for each and everything You give to us every day. Yes, even with everything going on, we are a blessed people. We enter into Your gates with thanksgiving every day we wake up. Lord, we encourage everyone to participate in giving to those who are less fortunate and who need our help. Lord, in Your precious name we pray. Amen.
For the beauty of the earth, for the glory of the skies, for the love which from our birth over and around us lies, Lord of all, to Thee we raise this our hymn of of the day and of the
of light. Lord of all, to thee we raise this our hymn of grateful praise. To sound and sight, Lord of all, to thee we raise this our hymn of grateful praise.
Thank you. heard it already. We started with a happy day and for the beauty of the earth and the gift to be simple. We could just stop right there and go home. That's it right there, right? Okay, there's a little bit more, but that's kind of where we're going, right? We just something simple. It doesn't have to be, you know, over the top, and it doesn't have to have all this eloquent language, because God's world is a beauty. Look at the beauty on the table. God's bounty. Look at that. It's gorgeous, right? It's just a reminder of who we're here and why we're here today. And I think that it's important for us to remember why we're here. If we come for ourselves, we come for the wrong reason. But if we come to worship God, hold on, because God is going to do something new in you and around you and in spite of you. And today, that's what my prayer is for us today. You know, it's easy to chase these rabbits when you get on social media and you go down a hole that you think, oh my goodness, how am I going to get out of? But I did come out of it. I found this video that was something that was really glorious and gracious. And I couldn't believe that I had found this. So it was this gentleman, he's 89 years old, and he delivers pizzas. Been delivering for years in his small town community, 5 or 6 shifts a week. Just making a little money here and there. And he had come to this house and become friends with this family. This family who had a Ring doorbell, who had the video. You could see this gentleman. It would record who came to the door. And over time, this family used that and put it on social media to show how sweet a man and the interactions. He'd come, did you order your pizza? Here's your pizza. Have a great day. How's your family? You know, things that, right, we remember what that used to be like, but we don't see that much now. It's hard to find those things. So they recorded this video over and over and over again, and they started getting some emphasis and pushback that people wanted to do something for this man. So the family decided to create a little fund to take up some money for this man. He kept coming and coming, and one day they decided to give him a $20 tip, and he was like, oh my gosh, I don't deserve this. I'm just delivering pizzas. And they're like, well, we care for you. We love you. And he goes, I love you too. You know, we're friends. Now, if you watch this video, I'll tell you, you'll cry. It just makes you, it's sweet. So they kept raising money and kept raising money. They went to the gentleman's house, and when they went to his house, he was shocked to find that they had brought a gift. It's a pizza box. And they opened up the pizza box, and there was a check inside. And the check had over $12,000 in it. And the man asked one simple question. Why did you do it? Why did people do it? Why would people give whatever it was they gave for a gentleman that they may not even know? Right? Why do we do those things? Giving in that way is so countercultural, isn't it? The world teaches us that we are to hold on and obtain all of this wealth instead of give it away. It is countercultural for us to give our possessions away than to hoard them for ourselves. I know at Christmas they're going to say, buy something for your loved one. They only care about your money. They don't care about you. But for someone to give out of your pocket for someone that they don't know, how countercultural that is. I'm going to read a scripture from Matthew. I love this scripture. I love this scripture from Matthew 25, verses 31 to 46. It's about the sheep and the goats. We know that story. So before I read it, I'm just going to make the declaration. None of us have the right to choose who's a sheep and a goat. And if you're going to choose who's the sheep and the goat, listen to the scripture. In the judgment, that's the king's, that's his authority, not ours. You just wait for that part, right? Here it goes. When the Son of Man comes in his glory and all the angels with him, then he will sit on the throne of his glory. Today is Christ the King Sunday. It's the last Sunday in the church year. Because next Sunday becomes Advent. It starts Advent. Hope and love and peace and joy. Oh my gosh, 2020, where has this been? We need this now more than ever. All the nations will be gathered before him, the king, and he will separate people one from another as a shepherd separates the sheep from the goats. Excuse me. And he will put the sheep at his right hand and the goats at his left. Then the king will say to those at his right hand, come, you that are blessed by my Father, inherit the kingdom prepared for you from the foundation of the world. For I was hungry and you gave me food. I was thirsty and you gave me something to drink. I was a stranger and you welcomed me. I was naked and you gave me clothing. I was sick and you took care of me. I was in prison and you visited me. Then the righteous will answer him, Lord, when was it that we saw you hungry and gave you food and thirsty and gave you something to drink? And when was it that we saw you a stranger and welcomed you or naked and gave you clothing? And when was it that we saw you sick or in prison and visited you? And the king will answer them, truly I tell you, just as you did it to the one of the least of these who are members of my family, you did it to me. Then he will say to those at his left hand, you that are accursed, depart from me into the eternal fire prepared for the devil and his angels. For I was hungry, and you gave me no food. I was thirsty, and you gave me nothing to drink. I was a stranger, and you did not welcome me. Naked, and you did not give me clothing. Sick and in prison, and you did not visit me. Then they also will answer, Lord, when was it that we saw you hungry or thirsty or a stranger or naked or sick or in prison and did not take care of you? Then he will answer them, truly I tell you, just as you did not do it to one of the least of these, you did not do it to me. And these will go away into eternal punishment, but the righteous into eternal life. This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. I was thirsty and Joey gave me something to drink.
Blessed are you.
Man, I'm about to lose my voice here. Don't you love how the timing works great in that? That's right. This is Christ the King Sunday, right? So it's the last Sunday of the church year. Christ is King. What does that mean to you? Right, you didn't wake up today and go, oh, Christ is King of my life. What does that mean for me? You may not have woken up any day of your life and thought, Christ is the King. What does that mean for me? Pastor Joey and I might have woken up and not thought about that either. It's just not something that really always comes to our mind. We say it and it comes in songs. We read it in scripture. But what does it really, really mean? So why would people give money to a stranger? Why would we do that? So the question that I have about the sheep and the goats, this is an important scripture, right? You can read it in a lot of different ways, and I want to tackle it in a way that's maybe a little bit different but still true to the text, is that if we have to understand the context of which these words were spoken. So to say Lord, to say Jesus is Lord in that time period, whether Jesus was alive a few generations after, would to be countercultural to the Roman government. The Caesar was the Lord and not Jesus. But as we know, in God's economy, Christ is King. And to call him Lord is appropriate. So this, first and foremost, is a countercultural text to the world. And the sheep and the goats, well, again, that is not for us to be to decide. Because just think about it. Over at the early service, I didn't have my collar on, but Joey had his collar on. And I told them, by me standing up, if I didn't stand up and were sitting in the audience, God, I can't even talk. If I was sitting out and not being able to be notified or noticed with Joey, everyone would have thought Joey was the pastor and not me. Just because of the way I looked and the way I dressed. You'd have been wrong. So, if we think someone's a sheep, man, they may be a goat. And if we think someone's a goat, well, they may be a sheep. Because let's be clear, we're all goats and we're all sheep. All at the same time. Right? So we go down that road, and I just want us to be clear, is that when we start dividing each other, that's the king's job. That's the judgment end. That's not our responsibility. So what is the question? Is it about doing good things to get to heaven? Well, if you come to Christ and you think, man, I got Jesus because I'm going to heaven, you better step off that train, because that's not what this scripture tells us. That's an outpouring of some other things, but that's not the whole point. If you're just doing this to get to heaven, again, friends, let me step you back. That's not what the scripture tells us. It tells us other things. Because we could just be the goat. We wouldn't have to do anything. Well, I got Jesus. I'm going to heaven. I'm good. No, you're not. Because when judgment comes, he's going to go, hey, you who went to church every Sunday because you're going to heaven, you're a goat. Go to hell. Right? Right? Hear that? So there's a distinction there. What is the question then about this passage today? What is so countercultural about it? So let me ask us this, Trinity. How can we be countercultural? Maybe the question is this. What happens at the end of things if I start right now and do something? What if I not wait till the end, but do something today? What if I serve someone right now? Right? That's what the text is saying. I was thirsty, and you gave him something to drink. Right? How will my life be different if Christ is king? What does that make a difference to us? How will it be different? What does Jesus want us to do? Trinity, what does Jesus want us to do? There you go. Love our neighbor. You'll find some signs outside as we go that have hashtag love your neighbor on them. I got tired of looking at all the political ads and all this mumbo jumbo on signs about love this, hate this, this and that. And I was like, it's time as the church we be countercultural and put something out there to say love your neighbor. Now don't ask me who my neighbor is, because Jesus is clear who the neighbor is. Love God and love your neighbor. So pick up one of those signs. Put it in your yard. If you got an HOA, hide it a little bit. Don't get caught. Don't get fined. I'm just going to warn you. I don't have to worry about that. Some of you might. That's okay. You know how that is. You know, put it where you put your pink flamingo in your yard. Just kind of hide it out somewhere. Okay? I'm just going to warn you there. Don't tell them, oh, Pastor Scott said to put it in the yard, and then you get fined $20, and then you give me the receipt. Don't do that. That wouldn't be loving our neighbor. But take one of those. Love our neighbor. What else are we to do, Trinity? Give food to Cab. Great, great story today. Give food to Cab. I was hungry, and you gave me something to eat. Friends, none of us are worried about where we're going to get our lunch today. But I would ask that we try for a moment to think, man, what would it feel like? No, there's some in the room that may have been in that situation or had an experience of that in some fashion. But to really not, you know, there are folks outside who don't care about whether it's Christmas or Thanksgiving. They just don't know where their next meal's coming from. It's not that they're not grateful. They're just trying to survive. So what are we to do? Give food. Give drink to someone who is thirsty. Visit people in prison. The task is for us to serve the people who are in front of us. Those right in front of you. Who walks up to you? Now, sometimes the task is that we say no. And you might say, well, wait a minute, it says to serve everybody. Well, sometimes the service is to say no. Because we're going to the future that's based on the past, but we're living in the present. And to get to the future that began back here, something in the middle has to either change or be different to get forward to the future. Right? Some of us struggle with that. Because we can't help everybody. But if I can't, you might. If you can't, you might, right? Right? We are all able to do what we're called to do. But as a church, we come together as a community of faith. We believe a lot of different things in this room. But I hope there's only one thing that we're very clear about, that Christ is King. No wavering on that. Because again, you got to answer to the King. Not Elvis. Not Prince Charles. Praise God that he becomes king before some point. Right? But Christ the King. That's who we're after. More importantly, that's who's after us. He's out there. Right? He's tugging at us. We're wrestling. There's a conflict of who the Lord is in our life. And friends, I'm just going to, this isn't funny here. Right? This is very serious. We're living in a very hard time. We've got a pandemic raging. We're trying to be safe. We're trying to do what we're trying to do. On top of everything else, there is grief in all of our lives. We're all facing that. We're not thinking clearly. We're doing crazy things. It's just an awful time. Yet, we're still persevering. We're still moving forward because Christ shows us these folks that come into our lives. There's a reason that why we're together. Why me physically, I'm here at Trinity. There is a reason why I'm here and why you're here today and those on Facebook Live, why you're watching. We have to figure out what that reason is. We don't really have to figure it out, but it's good to kind of figure where we're headed with this. It goes back to what we're doing. Our Trinity tree out there, I can see the tree from right here, has a bunch of names on it, a bunch of children on there. How are we going to help? What are we called to do? We got to get off our rears and do something for God's kingdom, whether it's a Trinity tree or whether it's giving money or getting food to cab or whatever it is. There's something we're all called to do. I know that we're in a pandemic and things are shut down. Let's be creative. How can we do this? One thing that we're doing as a church is that we're giving out these Advent wreaths to folks. So next Sunday, when the first candle of Advent is lit, those at home, especially those watching on Facebook Live, may have one and can light the candle with us. You might choose to light it with your family. Right? You may choose to participate that it'll have the same readings. Is trying to make a connection. Right? We need to be connected because we feel disconnected. I feel disconnected. It's just because I don't know what I don't know yet. But that's not going to stop us, right? We have to keep striving. What is God showing us and what are we called to do? Life in God's kingdom is not about big words, but it's about powerful actions. I'll say that again. Life in God's kingdom is not about big words, but it's about powerful actions. Pastor Scott, I can't pray like you, and I can't use those words, and I didn't go to divinity school. That doesn't matter. If you feed someone who's hungry, then there you go. You're not doing it for me. You're doing it for the King. And we do it to the least of those in front of us. Life in God's kingdom is not about what you have or who you are. It's about what you do. Not the letters before or after your name, but it's about what you do and who you are in that economy. We're either in the world economy of the world or we're in the economy of God. And to be in God's economy will be totally countercultural. People will look at us as crazy. There's a lot of folks who won't come back to church. The statistics are over 20%, 25% plus folks will not come back to church. They may not even watch online anymore. They're done, right? They're just done with it. Some will only watch online from here forward. And some will come back in person. But to be the church, how does that cause us to act, right? How do we respond to that? It's not about what the world values, but it's about what God values. What do you value? Do you value your car, or do you value someone else's life? That community that took care of that young man, 89 years old, right? Some of y'all, young, 89's young, right? They gave him over $12,000, the pizza guy. They took care of him. His life valued more than anything that they had. So when you take a child or a family, Trinity, or you give food to CAB, or you help Epworth or Senior Resources, all the ways that we can do that, think about that person. Pray for that person. Don't do it because you got the money. And don't do it because, I always take a tree. Right. I always do this. It's what I always do. Don't do it for that reason. Do it because I don't know them. And they don't have. But guess what? They actually have more than we have, right? Because you do it to the one of the least of these. You're doing it to the King. Man, that's powerful. You're not just wrapping presents, but you're giving gifts to the King. How do you approach a king? Right? The gifts. What did the wise men do? They knelt down. Right? You bow. When we pray, you bow your head, right? Reverence, right? So why do shepherds separate sheep and goat anyway, right? So in the world, in animals, goats are smarter than sheep. They're much smarter. Sheep, you got to herd them. You got to lead them, right? The shepherd leads them. You actually don't herd them from the back. You got to be in front of them and go, come this way. Goats are all over the place. Man, they'll eat you out of house and home. Right? Those of you who have goats or know about goats, oh my goodness gracious. They're smart now. They're cunning and sly. They'll sneak off and go and do, right? That's why the sheep and the goats. Interestingly enough, if we're sheep and we're in God's world, we're not real smart. Because God's going, follow this cross. And we're like, hey, the car over here looks great. Follow this cross. No, I want to go here. Right? So how do we move forward then as a church? I know recently that we aren't doing the job that we're called to do as a church. We are being disconnected with folks. We are disconnected with folks. We don't know who our neighbor is. I certainly don't know who our neighbor is. And I ain't getting much help with that. Because of the pandemic that's around us, right? It's hard. But how are we going to connect with our folks when they feel disconnected? I see you on Sunday, but I don't know most of you. I don't know any of you. But I love you. Because you're in front of me. And I'm called to serve those who are in front of me. Pastor Joey is the same way. He's called to serve those in front of you. So this is what it looks like to serve those in front of you, right? To take care and to nurture and to want to help and to guide. You know, things go right, things go wrong. They're not always going to work out right. But in the end, whether I'm a sheep or a goat isn't for you to decide, but it is for the King to decide in the judgment time. What does God value And then whatever God values, what do you value? If you love God, if you value Him, you're going to do what God wants us to do. You're going to love your neighbor. You're going to feed the hungry. You're going to give drink to the thirsty. You're going to visit those persons in prison. And prison doesn't have to always be behind bars. There are people who are stuck in their homes and facilities that are a prison. There are those who have mental illness that's a prison, right? There are those who are hungry that aren't only physically hungry, but are spiritually hungry. There are those who are thirsty that aren't just want the drink on their tongue like I want, but actually thirst for so much more. Trinity needs to be the place that is countercultural, that we don't have to think about that. We don't want to hurt people's feelings. Jesus wasn't worried about that. Because in the end, the king makes the decisions, not us. We need to love as God loves. We must give as God gives. We must forgive as God forgives. If your values are God's values, you can't help but live as Christ taught us. So how are things going to end? What happens after we die? Well, I don't know in full, only what I read in Scripture here. There will be some judgment. You're going to have to come before the king. But I didn't... No. We must start today. So I encourage you to take a sign that says hashtag love your neighbor. Put that in your yard. You got Trinity out there. You got CAB to give to. I know there's Epworth. There's senior resources. The missions team's doing a great job of trying to help with opportunities. There are other opportunities that you have. You want to give. So don't be bound by what we have, but do, right? God ain't going to judge you. Oh, I did it for Trinity. No, you're not doing it for Trinity, but you're doing it to the least of these, which means you're doing it for Him. So find that space for you and that place where you can give. If Christ is king, we know Christ awaits at the end of that story. This is the good news for us. We have a right to be a little nervous about that. I love when people say, oh, when I get to heaven and I meet Jesus, I'm going to hug Him and I'm going to tell Him all these things. No, you're not. Right? You could be down on your face. Because He's going to be too great and too glorious for you to even look at. Right? Right? Or maybe in my mind, I hope it's like this. He just holds His hand. And we grab it. And just hold on. And not say a thing. Because Christ will see us. He already sees us. He already knows us. He knows what we've done. He knows what we will do. But He's teaching us today. He claimed us as His own. We are the blessed children of God. So Trinity, what are we going to do? I'm here for a reason, for a season. That's 10 or 15 years. To do what God's calling us to do. And me and Joey are tired. We need your help. So how are we going to interact as a church in these times? Granted, it is hard. Our minds are racing with what to do. But man, we gotta do something. And it's in front of us today when you leave. It's an invitation. No one's making you do anything. If you want to walk out and not grab, that's you, not me. And there's no judgment, right? We're not judging people. We need to stop the judgment. It doesn't matter what school you went to, what political party, whether you grew up in the North or the South or male or female or black or white. None of that matters because that's just tearing people apart. But we are about doing God's work. Because love thy neighbor and love God are the two great commandments. We can believe what we believe, but when we tear people down, you're going to be a goat all day long. Now maybe that's my judgment, and that'll be your judgment too. But let's be like sheep. Let's at least seek to be the sheep. I want it to end well for us. I want it to end well for you. I can't make you do anything. I'll end this with this. I'm in a residency group. I'm a mentor for residents, for pastors who are working their way towards ordination. Joey will actually begin a residency group next year. And in there, you help and you guide the sheep along towards ordination through the boards and all these questions and things you have to do. And there were some that make it, and there's some that don't. And it hurts when they don't. And you take it personally. And as clergy, we take it personally sometimes. When we see people hurting, we all make stupid mistakes. And we all make decisions, or we have things happen that just are out of our control. So however I can help you, please let me know. I want to see you at least seek a better way. You hear me? I think you hear what I'm saying there. That's what I'm going to do. That's what I'm going to promise to do for you. Now, we have to promise to God what it is. So in a minute when I pray, just pray for God to speak to you. Pray for God to open your heart. One more crazy thing that happened at early service. I got up for the benediction, and I felt a stirring on my heart, and I said, you know, someone in here knows exactly what they're going to do. But I said, I feel more than one person. And I was quiet for a moment. I said, does anybody want to share what that is? Way in the back, I see this hand stand, raise up. And I said, yes, sir. This man stood up. He was from Free Will Baptist Church in town, had been coming. Might be the gentleman that was out at the picnic shelter when we were worshiping out there. And he says, you know what? Trinity is full of love. Trinity is a church where I feel that I'm not judged because I'm black. Or that, you know, I'm not a member. Right? But that I feel that it is a place of love. I turn around. I walk over to him, and he's talking to me. I turn around and walk to the band, and I just go, wow. Friends, the Spirit is real. I'm telling you, when it happens, it happens. It's happening, right? It's moving. The Spirit's moving. I want to thank you for doing the work that you are doing. You need to know that. This is a hard time. As hard as it is for me and Joey, I know it's equally as hard for you. I know we want to do more, and we can't right now. But there are other things we can do. For those who are leading and leadership and those who are doing Zoom calls and studies and all, I know we got an Advent study coming up. It's going to be by Zoom. The Advent wreath's going out. Goodness, it's hard. Some of you have had to deal with deaths in your family. I recognize that. Some of you are dealing with sickness and ailment, and that's hard. I don't have to tell you that. But know that I feel that. Know that I feel that for you. But know that this is our Father's world. What did Psalm 100 say? Make a joyful noise to the Lord. How are you going to make that joyful noise today? What are you going to do? What am I going to do? What's Pastor Joey going to do to make that joyful noise today? I'm not going to say amen because we got more stuff to go. Because I want us to look at the Apostles' Creed that's coming up, right? I believe that that's something that we need to say every time we worship. Because we need to know what we believe. I know that people in my ministry have come up to me and they said, well, Pastor, what do I tell people that I believe? What do I tell people? I said, go through the Apostles' Creed. You stand up every Sunday and just say it. You don't believe it, but you say it. Say it like you mean it. Right? You like how I threw that in there, right? It's true, though, right? I mean, I just go through it, too. So I'm going to make it easy for you. I have it now printed in front of me. I'm telling you, this is one of the parts of anxieties in ministry is that I blow saying this. Right? You learn quickly. You got to put everything in front of you. Because when your mind starts going, you forget. You got it up here on the screen. I can always turn and fake it, right? I've blown it 2 or 3 times in ministry, and man, that's embarrassing. You're like, oh my God. So that makes you feel easy, right? This makes you feel at ease. But it is what we believe. It is what we say as the church, is what we say as a person, that if you believe these things, then you believe Christ is King. And you believe that one day that there will be a judgment with goats and sheep and that it will be where it will be. I'm going to get us to stand, and we're going to say the Apostles' Creed. And we're going to say it from a heart like we mean it, like we believe it, and like we're going to live it, okay? Let us stand. I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. The third day he rose from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. You may be seated. Let's take this moment as you open your heart a little bit more. Ask God what he's calling you and calling Trinity to do in the church that he's calling us to be. Let's pray together. Oh, gracious God, what a day this is. Man, your spirit is flowing in and out. You are here. You are present with us, God. And you have called us here on this day to be present both here at Trinity and on Facebook Live. God, you are mighty and you are powerful. You have created this beautiful world. Man, we have not been good stewards. But you are still King. And you are God. And we continue to strive, oh God, so we pray that our hearts, as they're open, you will touch them in the ways that you do for each of us. For we all have different gifts. We all lead in different ways. We all serve in ways that might look different. Whatever that is, God, we all come in the name of Jesus the King. I pray and thankful for each family and person that is here in person and online. I know that God, that we struggle. We can get really pumped up as we gather together, and then we do get into our world where the economy in our world is all about me, me, I, and we forget our neighbor. We get frustrated because things don't go our way. Things aren't fixed in time because they're broken. We don't have enough money to do this. Our children are driving us crazy because they want that. We're not sure how we're going to make ends meet with our retirement because, well, we might outlive our money. God, we come and just lay that at your feet and just lay back and say, all right, you show us. You put somebody in front of me this week that I can serve. God, you have been here at Trinity for years. You will continue to be here. This church will be here generation after generation because the church will never die. Your spirit is strong. I can feel that presence in this room today. And I know that hearts are being tugged at, nudged. Unsure how to respond, and that's okay. But God, it's time for us to make a joyful noise. Make a joyful noise, not only for Trinity, but for you. In this community of Blythewood, or wherever we work, or wherever we go, people should look and go, man, there's something, there's just something about that person. May we take a sign that says, love thy neighbor. And as we love our neighbor, may people see that and go, hey, there's something different about that person. And even if they say, oh, they got that stupid sign up, God, we know that regardless of the words that come, though they might hurt, we're going to stand strong. Because your word is true. Your word is powerful. Your word protects us. We're going to do the best we can, God. For those people who are hungry that come before us, may we find a way to feed them. For those people who are thirsty and come before us, may we find a way to give them drink. For those people who find themselves homeless, God, may we find some way, whatever it might be, to help them. And for those who seek and find hopelessness, God, may we direct. For we know, God, we're not all gifted in areas. And that we can't take on all the challenges. And we certainly can't take them on by ourselves. And there are those who are trained and can have help. We need to seek those folks and to partner in. That's why, God, we know our community of Blythewood has to come together and work together to help the immense amount of need that is just right outside our view. All we have to do is look down. Because as people are below us, or at least we think, and looking to us because they think that we're the king, that we have, God, it is the other way around. For when we give, we're the ones who should kneel and know that we see you, O God, face to face. Every time we serve, in the name of Jesus the Christ. Go with us as we leave. Bless us. Encourage us. Love us. And show us grace. We now ask these things in the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior, who taught his disciples to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come. Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever. Amen.
Thankful people, come, raise the song of harvest home. All is safely gathered in, ere the winter storms begin. God our Maker doth provide for our wants to be supplied. Come to God's own temple, come, raise the song of harvest home. All the world is God's own field, fruit as praise to God we yield, wheat and tares together sown,
or to joy or sorrow grown. First the blade and then the ear, then the full corn shall appear. Lord of harvest, grant that we hold some grain and pure may be.
Even so, Lord, quickly come, bring thy final harvest home. Gather thou thy people in, free from sorrow, free from sin.
The recordings today. It's a good day, isn't it? We started with it's a happy day. This is a happy day. Don't worry about what's going to happen tomorrow. We got to take care of right now. Remember what I said, right? We're heading to the future. It's impacted by the past, but we're standing in the present. Don't put the cart before the horse. Slowly, with our simple gifts, whatever it is you have to offer, wrap it up, give it away, and kneel before the King. Because you never know when he's standing in front of you. Go in peace to love God, love our neighbor, this day and always.